Well, thank you for coming today. Oh my gosh, I was certain that nobody would show because of the weather. We would be talking to Jackie and...
I'm thrilled that you all made it. Thank you so much. As you might figure out, I'm Eileen and that is Doug.
And we do pronounce our names differently on occasion. I say Leunig every so often and Eileen says Leunig all the time. So, and it really isn't a thing about our name other than the fact that we appreciate the fact that people call us anything. So that's all about what it is.
We are thrilled to be part of the Emergence exhibition. We very much appreciate that. It's been a great opportunity for us, as is today. And again, we thank you all for coming. So the title of our piece upstairs is called Full Circle. So we're going to tell you a little bit of story about Full Circle.
Basically, the story of Full Circle is, this is literally a full circle endeavor for us. We started our process of what we call light painting back in 2009. We had an invitation from Picture This Gallery. Cheryl Dean asked us to put together a show. And in trying to determine what we wanted to do, we were out walking the dogs one morning, and a neighbor called out from his house. Didn't even come out to the street to meet us. He called out from his house and he said, "Have you guys seen the graffiti light painting that is on the internet?" And we said, "Oh, yes, we have. Kevin, thank you very much." And we continued our dog walk. And as we're continuing, I thought, you know, most graffiti light painting is where you take the flashlight and you shine it into the camera and you write your name and you spell it backwards and you do all this fun thing with flashlights. We started thinking, what would happen if you turned that flashlight on the subject and took multiple exposures of the subject and then recombined them later? And so this was our very first test after our neighbor drew it to our attention, where we went across the street from our house and we literally took some colored gels on some flashes and flashed it around and just tried this out. So this was the beginning of our doing the light painting technique, which we have then continued to do beyond that.
And I guess I would add, one of the things that might distinguish Doug and me from other local artists is that we collaborate on what we do. And I know people collaborate in different ways. Doug and I are together all day, every day. And we've chosen a photographic process that allows us to really collaborate. We work on this completely in tandem.
So if you ever question how many photographers does it take to take a picture, it takes two.
So from that initial test, we created this piece, and this was from 2009. This is in the woods, the same woods that Full Circle is, which is the piece upstairs. So this is the same part of the woods. And this is the very, I guess, the first test then to see if those different exposures could be combined in a way to make an image that we were satisfied with.
Now this is a screen capture from Bridge, which is a photographic catalog of images. And what you're looking at right on the right-hand side there, or left-hand side, whichever it is a portion of our first night evening's shooting of the light painting. And all told, there were 1,600 images through the 36 hours that we shot the light painting. And as the video shows, it actually is just a amount of choosing which of those frames you want to put together with another frame. So we've taken thousands of images, but then we only choose the ones that we want to put back together. So we don't light up everything that we want to see. We literally choose just like
we put the camera on a tripod, and it remains there unmoved for the entire shoot. And in the case of Full Circle, we started the night before the eclipse, the solar eclipse that was here this summer. And we put the camera up on the tripod and we worked that night until about 10 or so. And we warned our neighbors that we were going to be doing this because we can be very bright and we didn't want them to think that there was some kind of invasion going on. And so we told them that, and then we left the tripod out overnight, took the camera home. It's a nice neighborhood, but we still took the camera home. And then the next day went back in the morning. So I'm going to run this little video, And if you watch the screen that's on your right, you will see the light moving around.
So this clip is a minute long, and it goes all the way through the first night into the daylight exposures on the next day. And we stopped the clip here at the moment of the eclipse happening. And as you might remember, the day of the eclipse was started off gray and overcast. It got brighter. In fact, the sun actually did come out. We're in the second day. And so you can see the light moving around here, the sunlight. And we had planned for the sunlight to actually hit on the hero tree, as we like to call it, because that is exactly where the eclipse would have been shining down on it. We would have seen these nice shadows created by the eclipse. So that was the goal in mind. Well, the overcast didn't allow that to happen. But we also knew, because we planned this far in advance, that we were going to have a good image regardless of the eclipse coming through for us or not. So we did indeed accomplish that goal.
And what that little video showed you is over the first evening. So we had the camera set up before the sun went down, and we worked, as I said, till about 10. And we take turns. One works behind the camera, and one takes the light. And we go around, and we literally paint the scene with light. So I tend to use the flashlight. The strobe is a little big and heavy for me on a stand, so I use the flashlight. And I imagine myself as if I have a paintbrush and I'm painting a tree. We try to use the light from different angles, so we get a side light, we get an up light. If we have a tall enough handle on the strobe, we can get a down light on things. So we get all these different light angles. And based on that, then we go home with a palette. We go home with a digital palette that we then use to reassemble that image back into our vision of what we wanted to share. So this is one still image from the time-based art that's upstairs. And this particular one has probably 4 or 5 exposures in it. So we took each of those different exposures, and you start to put them together and marry them together in a way that you want.
This one's a little bit on the strange side, because we don't do all just realistic. We don't consider ourselves photojournalists. We consider ourselves artists. So we do strange things, like lighting the path with little spills of light, and this figure that kind of showed up. Again, when we do our light paintings, a lot of times things come out of nowhere that we don't even see ourselves. In fact, we had one show at the Art Guild that we went and shot a house that Lincoln stayed in, or a hotel. And in the upper windows of this abandoned building, a figure showed up in our light painting, which was kind of spooky. So anyway, this is a figure that showed up during our light painting of this.
And when we first started doing light paintings, we made prints of these. And so we were perhaps more judicious in some of the exposures. We weren't as radical then. And you'll see some of those early examples. But now that we are able to use this time-based technology, we can throw in things like this and kind of show a little bit of a wild side, if you would, for a light painting.
This is probably 10 or 15 exposures. Chosen to put them together as we want to light up the area.
Never so often we sneak ourselves into these shots. So Doug and I are both in this image, and I don't imagine we're back here. You can see I made the mistake of wearing light colors that night, so I'm a little more visible. But
yeah, normally we're wearing black, so you can't see us. And this is actually a silhouette of me on the path there. I don't show up much, but I was probably wearing black.
So we are going to now look at some of the early light paintings that we did. And one of the advantages with the technique that we use is we have all those different exposures. So you can go back and repaint the image in whatever way you want. This is the pavilion, or the pagoda, at the bottom of the hill in Glen Oak Park. Very interesting structure. And this is the second, well, I guess we did the light painting at the park. We did one of what is now the Children's Playhouse up top, and then we did this one. And I am fascinated with the structure, so I have reworked this image several times. And each time I try to make it look more like a spaceship or more normal, and I try to bring out more trees or more foreground. But it lets you play by using this technique. It's a great opportunity for that.
This, we decided to show the example of how when we use our lighting, we erase the light itself. So it's always kind of interesting to put a light on something and have the effects of the light, like the shadow here, the shadow from the bench. But we were standing just on the other side. And rather than shoot the whole frame and use the whole frame, we erase anything that we don't want in that frame. Again, not photojournalism, but art. So we're using the shadows created by our lighting that have no point of source as they would in reality, which makes them a little bit more surrealistic and unusually, in fact, all the light of our light painting is from below. We can't get lights up above. So trees are lit from below. Everything is lit from below. And that creates this unreal sense of our imagery. This one is, have you seen this picture on the Maxim building?
Yes.
You've seen it, but it's flipped. In fact, in flipping it, we actually had to reestablish the, it was not an easy task.
Yeah.
It took a while, but we did it. And the other thing about this, which is interesting, is this is a beautiful telescope, but it's also in need of repair. They took 20 years to gather enough money to put a new dome on this. And when we did this picture, we decided that it might be useful for them, for the Astronomical Society, to be able to use the picture to generate interest in restoring the telescope. So we digitally polished that. In reality, it was all tarnished, but we're through the miracle of Photoshop, able to make it look like it's brand new and dynamic. And it could look like this, but it's going to take a community to pull it through and work on it.
This is one of my personal favorites. This is Banner Marsh. And Doug and I were both, as children, very fortunate to have woods near our houses that we could play in and very much in tune with nature. And when we went out to Banner Marsh, there are several roads that go in, and we spend some time driving around trying to decide. And if we can't both agree on a location, then we keep going until we find a location. And when we drove by this, we both immediately said, that's the place, that's the answer. So we were there before sunset, which we frequently set up so that we can get a nice color in the sky. All those birds were coming in to roost for the night. And so there's probably about 15 exposures of birds to get that sky filled, and they would come in and they'd roost on the like the cattails in there and stuff, and you'd hear them, and then all of a sudden it was like they all got the message at the same time, and they would be just silent, total quiet, and then all of a sudden they'd all start up again, and it didn't seem to be related to anything we were doing, but it was a very nice experience, a pleasant way to spend an evening.
This is an image we did in Cuba. And we travel with our flashlights, and of course you need a tripod and the equipment, but that's part of our joy, is to do light paintings wherever we go, when we can find the time. And I think this is most significant, not only because we incorporated a couple of fellow travelers that were on the trip, and that woman had brought a formal dress with her to Cuba. I had an idea that she might be able to use it. Well, throughout the entire trip, this is the end of the trip, she never got a chance to use it. So when we invited her to be in our picture, she said, oh, can I wear my dress? And we said, by all means, do that. So one of the fun things about this picture is we were able to cast shadows of them up on the building. Now, obviously, that's a real impossible angle for light to happen. But again, through the magic of light painting, we can do whatever we want. And then Eileen had missed the opportunity to have horses in the shot, because there are horses passing around, and this is in Trinidad, by the way. And so we were about ready to wrap up the shoot, and Eileen's like, oh, I wish we had a horse come through. And minutes later, this guy arrives, and he was willing to pose for us, although he was kind of passing through.
He came back around, though. He came back a couple times.
And did a couple passes. So.
And in this case, we used a flash. We used a strobe on him. And it's harder otherwise to capture people because they tend to move subtly, and so you get a blur. The horse wasn't, as you can imagine, very thrilled with the flash, but it was a well-behaved horse. So the guy circled back around a couple times, and we were able to get that. So I felt very lucky, because that was something I wanted, and there he showed up.
This is in a cloud forest in Costa Rica. The interesting thing about this, to take your picture, is when we got to the cloud forest, it was great. It was heavily cloud covered, and we thought, oh, this is great. We rarely have the opportunity to shoot in fog. This is what we're looking for. So we got there, we took a hike to see where we might do the shot. Well, we didn't take our equipment with us. We had, scouting. And as we're scouting, the cloud is getting thinner and thinner. And I'm thinking, oh, we gotta make our decision fast. So I ran back, got the equipment, which was a fairly healthy hike. It was probably about 10 or 15 minutes. By the time I got back, the fog was pretty much gone. So, and again, not being photojournalists, we've recreated the sense of the fog through the little bit that was there, and we brightened it up a little bit more than the actual photo. But this is also what light paintings are good for. They're good for giving you the feel of what something is, not the exact information about it. This is our first night at the Arenal Volcano. We went out not really knowing what we were to expect. We'd never been in a jungle before. We'd never been in front of an actual volcano before. This was totally an unusual experience for us. And with the idea that we were out there uneducated about what to know or expect. And while we're out there, we hear this I'm thinking, is that a gorilla? Are we in danger? And fortunately, a group of people came by with a tour guide, and we said, hey, what is that sound we're hearing? What is that? That's really scary. He says, oh, those are howler monkeys, and they're about this big. They have a voice box on them that makes them sound like it. So that was our first lesson in jungle animals. But as you know, if you saw the white painting that was in the museum here, the Peoria Riverfront Museum before, this is one of the most dramatic white paintings that we've done. And it really is one of the things that is surprising.
In this case, we knew we were going to be going to this area, and we did our research to find out which part of the volcano was active, and discovered that, and ended up with a great room. They had a balcony, and we put up the tripod on the balcony, went about and did things, but the camera stays up, and we come back periodically and fire it until it's in the evening when we can start doing our light painting.
So I'm up on the balcony, and I'm sitting there taking the exposures. This one, of course, the day the camera's actually set up for over 24 hours. So again, having the camera there, anytime we walked up to it, we actually took the exposures that were there as we set.
Boom!
We had agreed that one of us, whoever was talking, was going to do this. Other person was
going to do it. I missed the cue.
Anyway, because of the fact that this thing erupted while we were shooting, I had the frame open, and I had the presence of mind to think, I saw the pictures in Life magazine of the photographer who shot his last images of the cloud of gas coming at him after the volcano blew up. And I thought, oh, is this it for us? Are we going to die? Boulder's going to start crashing around us. Well, about that same time, I had the presence of mind to know that, oh, I can't leave the camera open. I better do the exposures, otherwise it's going to be burned out. Meanwhile, Eileen is down there.
I'm doing the lighting at this point. And so I'm trying to light this one single tree, and there's this giant bug, huge in my mind, like a condor coming down. I'm doing this, trying to avoid the thing, and my back is to the volcano. And it blows up. It literally makes this huge boom. And the first thought for me was, we've got the shot. And I was so proud of myself because I was like, I feel like a photographer now. I know that we've got the shot. And then they sounded the evacuation siren. And I had read this information in the room that said, when they sound the siren, you have X number of minutes to get to a bus. The buses won't wait for anybody. They're out of here, and that's it. And so I'm trying to run back up there thinking, I'm going to die. I'm really in bad shape. I can't run that far. And when I got to the building, there was one of the employees there who said, "Muy grande, no problema." So it ended up being fine. Although the next morning at breakfast, this was a Smithsonian Institution place, the next morning at breakfast, the man who waited on our table said, when that thing exploded, the tourists went out to the observation deck, all the workers ran out the front door.
Went out the door.
Yes. So now we're going to switch focus to a different technique, a different style that we use.
And we call this dancing landscapes. Dancing landscapes require two photographers, once again, or two people. One person is actually driving the car, and the other person shooting out the passenger side. So we actually take turns shooting dancing landscapes. And I started this technique many years ago, and Eileen has since learned it. And I like to think it's easy, but it does take some timing. As you follow along with the subject passing by, when you marry your speed with the subject passing by you, the things that are still and frozen are sharp. Everything else that's out of that plane of reference will work. So these dancing landscapes are really a combination of energy and slowness. In fact, the most important thing to me about them is that they show a core of quiet in a world of chaos. So to us, dancing landscapes are all about finding your center core, finding the peace within you. And we have actually sold, we have a commissioned piece that was 60 images long in 90 minutes. And this is a speeded up version of it right here. This is actually, these are 20 seconds each or so?
Yes.
Whereas the actual art piece that was commissioned, these are changing every minute to 2 minutes, and it's a continuous dissolve to the next image, so there's an overlap that makes a third image, if you will.
And Jackie mentioned that she dances in the studio. For me, to do dancing landscapes, it matters what kind of music is on the car radio. Doug says it's a matter of matching the camera speed to the car speed. To me, it's a matter of dancing with the camera as we go by.
Contemporary Art Center asked us to do a show, and we chose our favorite subject, which is water. We had 26 pieces in it, and this is steam, and it's pretty well straightforward steam, except it's like our light paintings, it's done in multiple layers. So we've done 12 different exposures with a backlight on the steam to get the prismatic effect, whereas Eileen likes to say every drop has the potential for being a rainbow. And then we enhance that color in Photoshop. So this is just an example of our steam. But subject-wise, it's one of the most important things that we're doing.
In that show, water is one of the unique things in that it has three states that it can be in. And so we made the effort to get the solid state. And it happened to be a warm winter here, the year that we did this, unlike this winter. So we started calling northern states to find out who had ice. And very few did, but this is Minneopa Falls in Minnesota. And when we called to find out if they had ice, they said, "For climbing?" I said, "No, just for photographing." And they said, yes, that Minneopa was the farthest south area in Minnesota that had ice. So this is a two-tier waterfall that the first tier is very short, the second tier is a bigger drop. So that piece at the top is the water coming down and it freezes in the process and drops down. The first day that we got there, we had taken, of course, all our winter clothes, we got out of the car, sheets of ice all across the parking lot, and it's really cold.
Really cold. I swim below cold.
So we kind of slid our way over and you get to a walk and you look down on the falls, and there was a woman coming back up who had fallen through one thin part of ice, but it was very shallow. She said, "Well, you don't have to worry, it's real shallow." But we went off and we bought a harder gear, more, you know, heavier stuff and ice cleats, and went back out and did this, neither of us fell through, but the whole time, a lot of the life painting has an element of fear, big bugs, snakes, things like that. This, I kept thinking, I'm gonna fall in that frozen water.
Part of the thing is because we're always doing these at night, so there's a mystery of what might happen around you that you're not even aware of.
So we're gonna show you just some samples of current work. Now this is just a little sampler, so there's gonna be some slow motion video, and then there'll be some still images that pop up so that you would see some other pieces in there. A couple of years ago, camera technology changed enough that since we both photograph, if we're not doing a light painting, we both have our cameras out, and these cameras were affordable enough but they had a high frame rate video. And by doing that, that opened up another dimension for us. It opened up the dimension of time. So we have started to do more with time. And this requires, why not? Technology meltdown. Let's see, I thought I had connected the Wi-Fi. I'm sorry for the delay. It's on. Yeah, it should be up there. Oops, it's connected.
Yeah. I'll fill in the time. So this high frame rate stuff. This is 1,000 frames a second these cameras can do, and normal 1,000 frame a second cameras are like $25,000. These are not that. They're Sony product. RX10 is the name of the camera. And it really is fascinating, especially for water, because we have done an awful lot of work shooting water, waterfalls, flashing water, rain, dripping water. Anything that you can slow down to 1,000 frames a second, you can take 2 seconds of real time and turn it into a minute and a half. And that's a pretty amazing technology thing to do. And one of the things, I guess we will see some of it. And one of the things that we get to do with that is stuff like this, where water is just doing its normal thing, but in doing its normal thing, there's things like holes that open up, and you can see through those holes. And you can see things that you wouldn't normally perceive with your eye in real time. So to us, it's the fascinating part of slow motion is the fact that it changes the way you look at the world around you. And this is really what we're doing with our light paintings. This is what we're doing with dancing landscapes. And it's also now what we're doing with real video of the world around us. Of course, the water is one thing. These particular shot right here was in Plovdiv, Bulgaria, as I just said, of course. But this is all something that we don't normally see, even though it's right in front of us all the time in a whole different time frame.
I'm sorry, I kind of got distracted.
Okay.
I was trying to catch up.
And this is actually one of Eileen's favorite shots, is this particular one. And we put these together because we have we've had a request for some more of our time-based art, or time-based media, as we like to call it. And one of the things we're doing with that now is slow motion of people. Every slice of life, everyday things, just people walking along. This is in Chicago, along the Riverwalk, which we've gone many times to shoot the water. But now we're starting to look at crowds of people and people just conducting their normal business. And the significance of this, and what we enjoy about it, is because you're looking at slow motion, and you're looking at expressions, and you're looking at things that don't normally get considered by their being focused on, you tend to make judgments. I tend to make judgments about what I'm looking at and who I'm seeing, and I'm thinking, I know nothing about these people, and yet I'm judging them from slow motion video. So that's just an idea of how easily it is for us to pass judgment when we don't really have the ability to do so. Other things like this particular little girl playing, she's just having a joyous time. and we shot pictures of her for about 10 minutes, which then turned into 44 minutes worth of slow motion. But this is a joyful video for 44 minutes to watch this little girl play and have fun.
And I'll go back to a second for the Chicago River. We have spent enough time on that river walk, and a lot of times the cameras are pointed at the water and catching the water reflections, that we're out there early in the morning and we're there most of the day. So the Chicago workers or the people who are taking care of the river or the river walk come by and they kind of look at us. They come by later, you know, a couple hours later, and they will eventually say, "What is it that you guys are doing? You just keep looking at the water, you know." And then we show them the back of the camera with the reflections, and they get it. But we do seem kind of strange at times.
So this video is actually 10 minutes long. I don't think we need to look at too much more of it. Water garden, you want to show that?
We'll show just a little bit of this.
Water garden is one of our favorites, so we got to show a little.
So this is a composite image of, at the Como Conservatory in St. Paul, they have a water garden outside. And so some of this is from that water garden. But we also put a tub of water on our back deck with the plants that were out on our backyard. And then Doug periodically, there's a GoPro camera in the tent, the tub of water pointed up. And Doug periodically comes by with a water pitcher and pours water in. So you get this big disturbance in there.
And this particular piece is up in the store, up in the museum store here. So if you've got a few minutes to watch it, it's pretty engaging.
Okay.
Got a few minutes left.
Okay,
so this is the Peoria Courthouse, and obviously it's a picture of water that we call vase, and as you might guess, it's upside down. And the reason we like to turn things upside down or around is because when you're shooting water, outside of this is obviously a gravity-fed thing, but when you're shooting water, you don't have an orientation on it. There's no gravity when you're shooting down on something and you're looking at it from any angle that you want to look at. So this is an example of turning something upside down to make it a little bit different than you're normally looking at.
Okay. So we're going to switch to one more. Got to go back.
All right. The most important part of our presentation is the fact that John Morris made this statement to an Arts Partner meeting prior to his actually being starting his job. It was like 4 days before he started his job. But the idea behind this so struck Eileen and I as finally we have a leader in the arts that we can follow, that we can support, that we can really get behind. And this idea of us being the greatest arts community in America, we're miles from it. There's no way that we are even close to being this. But guess what? We can be. We can do this as a community. We can actually get our love and passion together and working together and make it happen. It's totally doable. Now, we've got a long ways to go. We've got a lot of things to do about it, but it's possible.
And many of you know John and Sharon Amdahl. They also have this goal. So, you know, Doug and I started talking about collaboration. This is very much a collaborative effort to make this community the community that we think it can be, that we all want it to be. So these are excerpts from, we write a monthly column called Art, What Is It Good For? In the Community Board newspaper. And we have started doing this as a comic book style. So those
we've done the graphic novel style for the last year, and in that year's worth of parts of the, we're now in the ninth part of our series, we have described all kinds of possibilities of working in education and everything, but this has led us to the idea that we want to have something big in Peoria, in Central Illinois, actually, not just Peoria. So we first started writing about, in part four here, we were writing about the Public Arts Festival, and arts being, with the S, performance and music and theater and all the things that the arts stand for is something we need to celebrate, and we need to celebrate in a big fashion. So we took that idea and named what we would like to see happen as Big Picture Festival. Again, this is something that we believe is possible. Right now, we've got people that are raising their hands. In fact, Maggie and Mark Misselhorn have raised their hands to help us with this. And we expect a lot more people, like Barbara Perry is also mentioned that she'd like to help. And we've had probably 24 people overall in time mention that they'd like to help.
And we bring it up today because we are very much collaborative people, and we would like to encourage all of you who have an interest in joining us in this. The festival is going to be next October 13th, so please get in touch with us, and we'll figure out how we're going to work together on that. So. Sure. And we'll take some questions. If you don't, would you all mind bearing with us for one more moment?
No.
Okay. So Doug and I started collaborating at a request. We both are former Caterpillar employees, and in 2002, I was working in a position that required me to put together an all-employee meeting. And the person who was in charge of the meeting asked if Doug and I would collaborate on creating a commemorative piece for 9/11, because the meeting was going to be held on the one-year anniversary of 9/11. So Doug and I said, yes, we'll take that on. And when we reflected on it, we felt that it was important for us to not dwell on a past, but to look toward building a future. So this is the first collaborative piece that we did, and we would like to share this.
Sound?
I hope so.
Thank you.
have it in our power.
Are there any questions that we could answer? Well, thank you all again for coming out today, for braving the weather. We very much appreciate it. It's nice to see all your happy faces, so thank you.
Thank you.